tell us a little bit more, like what are the most important changes in our life that are not material? Like what do you, other than mental health, what are the things that actually change here?
Well, yeah. So look, the big one, I'll just start with a really big one. And this is, you know, there's a long running debate around this in the history of technology industrialization, but I think that this the following point applies here, which is like, what kind of life, you know, should a human being live? Right. And to be clear, like, I'm not like a UBI, I'm the opposite of a UBI person. Like, I'm not a UBI person. I'm not a communist. I think it's a bad idea to pay people to not work. I think we're running an experiment in this country right now to pay a lot of people not to work. And, it, you know, it's sort of a big catastrophic mistake. And so I'm definitely not that. Having said that, you know, there is a fundamental question, which is what should the human experience be? How should people live? And in particular, and again, this is a classic kind of argument for industrialization, which is like the baseline there is, I don't think people should have to live lives of drudgery, right? Like, I don't believe people should have to, you know, 300 years ago, the conversation would have been agricultural technologies. And I would have said, I don't think people should live lives as subsistence farmers. You know, 100 years ago, we would have said, I don't think people should live life just as factory workers. Like, we should create new kinds of white collar jobs. 50 years, I would have said people shouldn't be just like stuck in an office doing paperwork all day long. They should use computers, right, to do the paperwork instead. And then today, what I would say is, look, most of the drudgery of life, most of the things, and you know, like everybody knows, everybody, you know it when you see it, right? It's when you show up and it's like, okay, there's the form and there's the thing and there's the, you know, you open up your email and there's the 200 emails.
I mean, shouldn't some of our associates be building a few of these spreadsheets? Isn't that good for them to get a little like, should they be using AI for all of it?
Yeah, maybe at some point they should learn how to do it by hand. I have an 8-year-old and he is getting taught how to like add numbers by hand. He's actually learning Mandarin. So his Mandarin teacher also has taught him how to use an abacus. In the worst case scenario, right, of an EMP, you know, nuking everything, he'll be able to at least add up numbers. Look, people should get trained, like people should have skills, and we could talk about that. But like, should you go through life as a human being doing things that machines can do for you? I think generally speaking, the answer to that is no. You should go through life doing the things that uniquely people can do. And to be clear, I think there are many, many, many things that people can do. I think people explore, I think people create, I think people help other people. My aspiration would be that increased technology, and in particular AI, should basically actually make it possible to be more human. You should be able to spend more of your life doing things that are human in their nature and human in the sense of fulfillment, as opposed to doing the things that the machines can do for you. This is one of those things where, like, if this really works, this really holds out that kind of opportunity.
It's a very optimistic take, which I share with you, which is that as technology improves, we get to spend more time being human, doing human things, doing natural things. It's kind of the opposite of this dystopian movies we see, which would show us being more in a tech world. We actually should be more in a human world. And so I love that optimism. I'm not used to getting optimism from you like that, Mark, because when we talk about this in the past, we talk about the productivity, for example, in healthcare, the productivity in education, the productivity and all these things that have gone down in government and bureaucracies in particular. You've not been optimistic that AI will be allowed to solve these areas. Like, has your thinking on that changed at all? Do you think some of this we will be able to change now?
Yeah, that's the problem. And I actually wrote a very specific piece in my Substack, if people want to see it, which very specifically addressed this question of whether technology would sort of AI will eat all the jobs and leave nothing for people to do productively. And the point in that essay is what Joe just said, which is like, it will be illegal to do that. Like, it's not going to happen because it's going to be illegal. Like, AIs are not going to get certified as doctors and lawyers anytime soon. Like, that I know for sure. There's going to be like tremendous institutional basically resistance and pushback. And Joe, like, as you alluded to, like, that's not new. Like, we've been in this 50-year period of actually very low productivity growth and very low technological change throughout our society, which is sort of the opposite of what a lot of people think they've experienced. But like, just practically speaking, most of the big important sectors in our society have either gone stagnant or moved backwards technologically and economically in the last 50 years. The big industries, like the really big ones, are not like video games and like, you know, the fun stuff that we like to do as VCs or as consumers. The big important, you know, the big industries as a percentage of GDP are healthcare, education, housing, law, government, and military. And those things have stagnated or moved backwards in terms of productivity growth. By default, the system as we are living in it today, it does not want the kind of change that I'm talking about. It does not want rapid productivity improvement. It does not want rapid, you know, adoption of these things. But you know, I'd say that's all a choice, right? That's like a collective choice that we've made to order our society that way. It's a collective choice that we've made to elect politicians that impose those policies, and those are all things that we could choose to do differently anytime we want to.
Is that really a collective choice, or is it sometimes special interests that are tricking us and making, because the average person would probably vote for it differently? Like, I mean, isn't it our job? Isn't it your or my job? I mean, Hamas buying a hospital now with billions of dollars, trying to make it more productive to scale. Isn't it our job to kind of get in here and kind of force it in here and show people that our answer is better? Is that too hard, or how do you approach that?
So, you know, H.L. Mencken said, democracy is the system of government by which the common man knows what he wants and deserves to get it good and hard. And so like at the core of it is like the voter, like at the core of it is the citizenry as a whole. And, you know, look, it's the great paradox of government, right, that is in front of us today, which is, 90% of us like our congressmen and 10% of us like Congress. Right. And it's just like, okay, like, so we're getting the result that we all vote for. The answer though, is what you said. Like the answer is what you said, which is basically brave people just have to step up and basically demonstrate that there's a better way. Like that's the only way that things can possibly change.
I think that's really important. And I think that's really important. So for example, you know, I give this example in Texas, there's a lot of things where we've changed incentives. The vocational schools at the high end have twice the salaries coming out because we changed how they're funded. And I don't think people were for the shittier vocational schools. They just didn't really understand, I think, that the way they were doing it was leading to students getting worse results. And it seems to me like right now you have very, very powerful healthcare interests in our country. But I think the average person is not for paying more for their hospitals. They're not for having worse results for their kids, you know, kids' health. They're actually for the better answer, but they don't understand how broken things are. You don't think there's some role for, I mean, one of my obsessions recently is the idea of, you know, the most competent people in our society actually getting more involved in a few of these things that the way our founders thought we were supposed to and fixing it. Is there some of that could go on with AI that is finally so obvious that it's broken that we get it and we fix some of these things, or you think it's too hard?
Yeah, look, I think that's what we have to do. Like I said, somebody needs to actually demonstrate that these things are possible. They need to be presented to people. They need to be made as much of a fait accompli as possible. I'm 100% on board with that. I mean, look, my big observation would just be that you have the technological change and potential running up against societal structures and the nature of the societal structures that we have. Like, you know, we say things like we live in a capitalist economy and we live in a whatever market driven system. And like, it's only on an exception basis that that's actually true. Like most of the economy is one form of cartel or another. Like, as far as I can tell, it's like, you've got the education cartel, you've got the healthcare cartel, you've got the banking cartel. And then you've got cartels of workers, you've got unions, that are literally cartels. You've got government. Government's always the most amazing thing, because somehow in government, you're able to have both civil service protections and public sector unions, right? You've got like a double layer of cartel, in which nothing can change. And so most of our society, and then you've got, you know, you guys, I'm sure, all know occupational licensing. You need 600 hours of training to become a beautician or some crazy thing in a lot of places. Like, our system of society and economics has been geared, you know, primarily to protect the status quo and to protect incumbency. And that's true in most industries. That's true across most of the economy, most economic activity. I just want to be kind of objective and blunt about that. Like that stuff is real, and it is a real challenge. And Joe, to your point, like there are two ways to kind of address that. One is to try to go in and fix that directly, right? They're like try to change those laws or change those regulations or change those cartel structures. And I'm totally in favor of that for anybody who could do that. But look, the other way is just simply show up with a better approach, like, and just basically like show up and like, okay, I'm sorry. Like, I know that, you know, the entire medical profession wants to prevent AI doctors from being certified, but like, here's an AI doctor and it works incredibly well. There's also just simply a fait accompli component to this. And I let's put it this way. I think that's at the very least also necessary. We could probably debate which one is more important.
Yeah, no, I mean, in my experience, when you have these really broken systems, if you do something like 10 times better, I don't know how to measure 10 times, but something so obviously better that it shames people and you're persistent, then eventually you kind of break into them as well. So it sounds like you're more in favor of that approach. I mean, because you are investing now in defense, you are investing in these other areas. These are cartels, and yet you are attempting to make money doing it. Is it because you're optimistic that if you're so much better that sometimes you'll break through? How do you think about that?
Well, the thing that you know about these cartels, you know, monopolies, oligopolies, cartels, the thing you know about these things, bureaucracies, right? They're just not going to do new things. Like, they're just simply not going to do new things. They're not going to invent new things. They're not going to change things. You know, but those systems are wired for status quo, preservation of the status quo. That's the whole point. And so they're just not simply not going to do new things. And so the bad news is the system is wired to not do new things. The good news is the whoever is going to do a new thing is not going to be one-upped by those organizations. Like the opportunity to do new things is wide open because it only happens on an exception basis. And it primarily only happens through a very specific, set of people doing something, in a very specific way to do something new, a startup company or its equivalent in another sector. And then look, to your point, like I would say substance matters, truth matters. If I show up with an AI doctor and it works, it's not like the status quo is showing up with like a different AI doctor and we're going to have a discussion of whose AI doctor is better. The other side is going to show up with the status quo. Right. Yeah. And so if the new thing is actually real and has substance, and has the truth behind it and really is better, then people are going to get to vote, and they're going to get to vote with their eyeball, with their attention. They're going to get to vote with their wallets. Ultimately, they're going to get to vote at the ballot box. And I very much agree with what you said, notwithstanding my little wisecrack about democracy. But I mean, look, like sort of rank and file ordinary Americans, like don't have time to think this. Even if they were capable of like being educated on all these different topics and wrapping their heads around it, whatever, they don't have time. Like they're trying to live their lives, and so fundamentally, a lot of what we're talking about is a war of elites. Look, the elites that are basically driving stagnation and incumbency are not particularly appealing people.
You're going to crush them.
Yes. And so like, in the fullness of time, it should not be that hard to kind of take to ordinary people, a better vision and a better way to do things.